Hello friends, let us know what Jimmy has to say about the portrait of an artist as a young man. A portrait of an artist as a young man is marked by the use of consciousness that is least dual. First, there is Stephen's consciousness that helps in capturing the intimacy that a first-person narrator normally enjoys. Then, there is a maturer consciousness that runs parallel to Stephen's point of view. It works to qualify Stephen's consciousness mainly through humor and irony. A portrait, in terms of genre, can be seen as an aesthetic autobiography or can be known as Bildungsroman novel, a novel dealing with artists' moral and psychological growth. It traces the religious and intellectual awakening of young Stephen Dedalus, Joyle's fictional alter ego, whose surname alludes to Dedalus' Greek mythology's consummate craftsman. Stephen questions and rebels against the Catholic and Irish conventions under which he has grown, culminating into his personal self-exile from Ireland to Europe. Synopsis and themes. The narrative deals with the complex themes like knowing oneself and one's true calling, that is, identity, religion, sexual awakening, myth of Daedalus and Icarus, and finally, the freedom, that is, liberation. Let us understand and know how these themes are beautifully interwoven in the 5 chapters into which this novel is divided into. The first chapter of A Portrait shows the Stephen's development from an infant's awareness to the first assertion of his identity in an act of protest against injustice in a dining room scene. The second chapter shows the growing isolation that comes with his adolescence. It culminates in the encounter of a prostitute and his relation with her. The third chapter represents the crisis of the adolescence and a temporary toying with the idea of taking up priesthood as a vocation. The fourth chapter represents the climax of the development in his recognition of his true vocation and his true calling as an artist and not as a priest. The fifth chapter shows the completion of his development and the declaration of his creed of freedom. If we take the first 2 chapters as a structural unit, then we find that these 2 chapters together trace the awakening of religious doubts and sexual instincts, culminating in the physical experience with the prostitute. The next 2 chapters together as a structure continue the cycle of sin and repentance. The fifth chapter, however, is a little different and it stands a little apart in terms of ironic distance from his own self. This chapter brings Stephen to the verge of exile and brings to the forefront his aesthetic theory and his life goals. Language and style. The major style or the technique used is the stream of consciousness technique. The stream of consciousness technique is nothing but can be known as a train of thought. A portrait has so many passages in which we see the person talking to himself, writing down things that he feels and experiences more in his diary than talking verbally to other people around. One of the Joyle's major stylistic achievement in his first attempt in portrait is the modulation on styles throughout. As we read the novel, we are going to realize that Joyce uses a different style in each section to underline each stage of Stephen's development. Each style is meant to represent a different stage in Stephen's progress towards the final realization of his true vocation, of his true calling as an artist. The changes in the style are deliberately highlighted. The novel is set in motion by the formula one would use for starting a fairy tale. By a selection and patterning of language, Joyce is able to mimic the growth of a child's mind in first chapter. His mother had a nicer smell than his father. She played on the piano Sailor Hornpipe. Tra-la-la-la-la, tra-la-la-la-la, tra-la-la-la-la. And once upon a time, there was a moo cow. Moo cow coming down along the road, and this moo cow that was coming down along the road met a nicest little boy named Baby Two Cow. The unusual narrative links are replaced to large extent by verbal echoes and associations. There is a direct representation of sensation, feelings and impressions. In the second chapter, as the child grows, the idiom changes and the range of interests become wider. Now the language and the perceptions are those of a schoolboy. Further, we come across a mind becoming aware of itself and of the body. He kept on the fringe of his line, out of the sight of his perfect, out of the reach of the rude feet, fingering to run now and then. He felt his body small and weak amid the throng of players, and his eyes were weak and watery. The third chapter traces Stephen's adolescence from the first awakening of sexuality and his growing isolation from his own family. In the first chapter and in this section, we find Stephen's nauseated with the reality of his life as well as with the avenues of escape that are available to him. He now thinks of meeting with an idealized woman. This hope is presented to us in a parody of sentimental romantic fiction. The style matches Stephen's cultivated posturing and his romantic reading, in which we read, "In secret he began to make ready for the great part which he felt awaited him." In the fourth chapter, however, he thinks of becoming a priest. We come across a different kind of rhetoric. He says, "I pray to God that my poor words may have availed today to confirm in the holiness of those who are in a state of grace." One of the climactic epiphanies in the novel is represented by the sight of the wading girl and its effect on Stephen's personality. The prose, with his buoyancy, lives up to the demands of the occasion quite well. Stephen, on looking at this wading girl, exclaims, "Heavenly God," in an outburst of profane joy. Stephen turns away immediately after he comes across her beauty. Stephen's cheeks were aflame, his body was aglow, his limbs were trembling, on and on and on his throat, far out over the sands, singing wildly to the sea, crying to greet the advent of the life that had cried to him. The wading girl's image had passed into Stephen's soul forever, and no word had broken into the holy silence of ecstasy. Her eyes had called him and his soul had leaped at the call. Thus, we see variety of styles made use of symbolism. Birds, water and colors are chief among the symbols that Joyce has woven into the structure and texture of a portrait. The bird image later comes to be associated with flight, freedom, liberation and transcendence. First, there is a figure of Icarus rising above the waters that occurs to Stephen's mind on seeing this wading girl. Still more significant is the wading girl, this wading girl, who is envisioned as having been transformed into a sea boat with the delicate legs of a crane standing in the water as if poised for flight. Her bosom is like the plumage of dove. Along with the chief symbols, two more things have very important symbolic significance. These are flowers, roads, and water. Both play an important role in Stephen's mental makeup and his baggage. The rose symbolism in the novel is very complex. It is dark yet pretty. The association of roads are tied up with walks and wandering, as though Stephen not yet knowing what he is up to. These are also part of the topography of Dublin, which in reality act as a part of Stephen's internal landscape, that is, his internal mind makeup and how he imagines Dublin to be. We see that Joyce mostly keeps his symbolism in a fluid state so that the connotations keep changing most of the time. That is it for today, guys, and this was the video. If you like the video, please hit the like button and click to the subscribe icon. The book is available on Amazon and you can always have it. Thank you.